So welcome. This is the last talk of the day. This is Oleg Moiseenko. He's at Bristol-Myers Squibb Company, which is a new member this year. We're very excited to have them. His title is IRODS and Use Case of Bristol-Myers Squibb between IRODS to manage genomics data, petabytes of genomics data.
Thank you, Terrell.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. I'm Oleg Moiseenko. I work as a senior scientific cloud engineer for an American company called Bristol-Myers Squibb. First time in IRODS user group meetings. Really excited. Thanks for having us. And we're relatively new in IRODS. We start our journey less than 2 years back. And so don't expect too much technical details from these presentations, but we hope to learn from experts in this room, and we will definitely quickly catch up. So first of all, today I will talk about how we leverage IRODS to manage petabytes of genomics data in Bristol-Myers Squibb. And before I proceed, let me say a few words about my company. So in a nutshell, we are a big pharma company. We produce drugs. And as this title is, as this slide states, our mission is to discover, develop, and deliver innovative medicine to help patients in a few areas. Oncology, immunology, hematology, and few others. And we are quite good in this. So this is just a small snapshot of our sales. And as you understand, as many speakers already spoke today, all this requires a lot of research. And research produce data, and we manage really, really big data. You could see how our data grow on an exponential rate on an early basis. And today we are in petabyte scales. I would say dozens of petabytes. It's a lot of data. Probably after astronomy, life science is a second producer of data in the world. And that's why we come to IRODS, because we need to track our data, we need to manage this. Our major data sources, probably the biggest one is raw data what comes from a fleet of scientific instruments. We also have a lot of data in Scratch space. We keep a lot of results data. We continuously have a lot of collaborations with external data providers, university institutes around the globe. And we also download a lot of data from public and government agencies. And of course, we do research and development work internally based on this data. And let me give you a few examples of our scientific data sets. It's genomics data, NGS data from sequencers, proteomics, flow cytometry, and many, many hours. And in many cases, we have federal regulations what requires us keep data for a long period of time, 10 years, 15 years, sometimes even 25 years. And you need to keep this data, you need to backup this data, making sure that data is recoverable at any point of time. So it's really difficult to manage so massive amounts of data. And when at the time, 2 years back, when we start looking for a good data management platform, we pop up with these key acceptance criteria for such platform. On the top of this list, you see cloud integration. This is because we really heavy in Amazon Cloud, and our goal is by end of 2020 to be 100% on a cloud. Then, as I already said, we in petabyte scale, so this data management platform is supposed to capable to manage such big data. We need this because our data should have a good metadata tags, and this system should support this. And of course, good security is also our top priority. And very important aspect of future data management platform for us was good established presence in life science and healthcare. And after some research, we found iRoads, and now we start using it. But we, since beginning, we decided to deploy iRoads not on local data centers, but on cloud. And here's why. Because first of all, we want all our data moved to S3 storage, object store. I will not explain why, but probably many of you know that it has practically no limits for data size. It provides a really good data protection. It already comes with built-in data distribution and replication. And once data arrives to S3, it's easy to integrate with other services on cloud. And as I mentioned already, majority of our data pipelines and workflows already were. So it would be easy for us. Before cloud, we had a lot of experience with storage hardware, and after many years we found it's not that easy to manage all this hardware in data centers because data is way too big and it costs a lot to maintain this hardware, tapes, data centers, and now we're trying to reduce our data centers footprint and moving everything to a cloud as much as we could. And cloud also provides elasticity, what is very convenient for iRoads as well, because when you see that you need more power, computational power for iRoads servers, you could just quickly add additional workers, or maybe you could scale up rebooting same iRoads servers on EC2 instances with high CPUs and memory. And this way, it just costs you 10 minutes downtime and upgrade completes. So it's very fast and effective. And in our case, we found that low cost on cloud, in fact, is cheaper and more affordable than hardware administration and maintenance. So let me say a few words about our use cases. So far we found four different use cases for iRoads. The first one, NFS and S3 data sync, was the main reason why we ended up with iRoads, because at that time we need to synchronize our local data sets with cloud. And when we are talking about petabytes, it's not that easy to copy all data from to cloud and making sure that nothing is lost, no corruption happened. And this is where iRoads helps us a lot. So basically, with help of iRoads, we scan local data sets in data centers, mostly through NFS protocol. When we scan S3 buckets, we compare these data sets, and if some difference found when we replicate data from NFS to S3, if no difference is found, we just disconnect local storage. This is one use case. Another use case is data management. We want to leverage iRoads to move data from scientific instruments to S3 buckets. Third use case is data lake integration. So basically, we have enterprise data lakes, and we have a lot of data in genomics, computational genomics team, iRoads will stay in the middle and serve as a genomics data hub for enterprise data lakes users. Any applications or users would come from data lake side supposed to query genomics data through through iRoads. And the last use case, which currently pretty much just like idea, is we want to engage machine learning and deep learning algorithms against iRoads metadata in future. We feel there would be a lot of potential because basically once we register all our data, iRoads metadata catalog will be a huge repository of knowledge about our data, and we definitely can use machine learning algorithms to mine this data. This slide shows our architecture on a cloud. So on the left side, you see local storage. It's mostly NetApp storage, what connected to a public cloud, Amazon cloud, through AWS Direct Connect link. It's a 10 gigabit speed link. And in this corner, you see a bunch of S3 buckets where we keep our data. And in the center, we have multiple EC2 instances, virtual machines. Each machine plays different role in iRoads catalog, and we use AWS RDS database. In our case, it's a PostgreSQL database to serve as an iRoads catalog. And all data what iRoads scans NetApp data on left, and this data comes to S3 bucket. And enterprise data lake interact with iRoads through genomics data hub portal. So this is how it looks like now, but in future, once we finish scanning our and replicating our local data sets on the left, this portion will go away. You will see how we, this is basically our journey to iRoads. We start our experience with iRoads in November 2017. At this time, we signed a pilot statement of work. When we delivered a small pilot project with iRoads, it was very successful and triggered a lot of interest in our company. When we signed a production SOW, in September 2018, we started first production deployment for computational genomics team in Bristol-Myers Squibb. And now we almost done with scanning and replicating our local data sets to a cloud. And meantime, we signed IBM's IROTS consortium membership as well. So we become members of this consortium. And in future, we want to deliver genomics data hub. It's a connectivity between enterprise data lakeing and IROTS environment. And then we probably will deploy additional zones for our teams inside Bristol-Myers Squibb who become interested in IROTS. And this way, we want to move toward BMS data farm or data grid. So while working with IROTS for 2 years, we found this is a great product with many pros, but we also found a few disadvantages. So first of all, it's easy to deploy. You could build a workable IROTS environment pretty much in 30 minutes. It's indeed metadata driven. It has a flexible rule engine, which we still need to learn how to use. With help of IROTS, it's easy to implement same names for logical and physical file paths, what is personally I found very convenient. It has good established presence in life science, as we already heard from today's presentations. It comes with a rich API, what especially valuable for our developers who wants to integrate IROTS in our applications and products within my company. It's capable to manage petabytes of data. This is a very important topic. And it comes with good security and flexible enough to be integrated with already existed workflow and data pipelines. In same time, there are a few disadvantages. So first of all, IROTS requires some additional learning and it has, I would say, higher complexity level because quite often you need to learn at least Python and be capable to write some code. And another aspect, what I want to mention is our scientists currently struggle with, in many cases, with good metadata. So it would be nice to have sort of metadata templates in IROTS, what would help our scientists to describe projects well in consistent manner. And the last aspect which I want to mention here is currently we use only two graphical users interface. I'm talking about cloud browser and MetaLinx. These plugins are really good, and in many cases, people who are not Unix savvy found them useful, but we think both plugins quite basic at this point. So it would be nice if IROTS continue to develop these plugins and mature them for future usage, adding additional functionality. So challenges, what we met so far. First of all, checksums. When you migrate a lot of data from local storage to cloud and really want to calculate checksums for all files, this process might take forever. And unfortunately, in our case so far, because our deadlines very strict, we decided to do not calculate checksums yet, but just leverage file names, file sizes, timestamps only. But in future, definitely we still want to calculate checksums for all billions of objects inside of our data stores. Scanning speed, it's still very slow. So probably if your data sets in terabytes, in gigabytes range, it's good. But if we are talking about petabytes and billions of small files, I wish to have faster scanning speed. On S3 side, it works great. It's capable to scan S3 buckets with a bunch of data insights in minutes, maybe hours. But if you need to scan local storage through data link connectivity, it might be slow. So that's why we want to move everything what we have on to a cloud, and this way we will close this. Sometimes you need to help iRoads. If you want copy a bunch of files through iRoads, sometimes it's better if it will be more convenient if you copy these files manually to S3 through other methods. It might be AWS command line interface tool, or it might be just maybe special storage appliance developed by Amazon called Snowball. And once data arrives to S3, you could leverage iRoads to rescan your data and compare this data against local storage to replicate any deltas if you want. Quite often we face many issues with how our data named, since our scientists leverage a lot of different tools to produce this data and manage this data. We saw many occasions of bad characters in file names. And these bad characters might cause iRoads S3 plugin fail during a scanning. So you need to fix this manually and rescan this data. Permissions issues, when you scan data from Amazon environment, from a Unix instance in Amazon environment, and you scan data currently present on local on another machine, occasionally you might face some permissions issues and you need to fix these permissions. I'm talking about the Unix permissions. In order to give iRoads server access to your data, but it's easy to fix. Once we got issue with Redis cache, we think it was a bug in Redis software. So once we discover it, we rescan this data, restart this service, and fortunately it was never happened again. Verification upon data sync process completion. So we trust iRoads, but sometimes when you deal with some very precious data, you want to make sure that iRoads is right as well. So I wish to have iRoads to check iRoads. But it's not possible. So anyway, you need to develop some internal verification mechanism to make sure that indeed no data left behind. So this is a short wish list what we develop inside of my company for iRoads. First of all, we really like NFS Roads plugin. I think this is a great idea to present iRoads storage through NFS protocol, and we wish you mature this and do this product production scale plugin. We also see a lot of potential in similar plugin for S3 storage and it's called Minio IROTS Gateway for S3. This way, we could definitely would be interested in this plugin and want to use this in future, because all of our data will end up in S3 anyway. We wish to have better LDAP integration to authenticate users in IROTS. Metadata templates, I already mentioned this. It will be a great help for our scientists instead of trying to maintain different rules. It would be nice to just apply already existing metadata templates to our objects in IROTS storage. We wish to have better IROTS catalog structure specs, because occasionally I receive requests from our developers that they want to explore IROTS database, not through IROTS server, but through read-only connectivity directly to a database. And they don't have a good document, what well describes all IROTS tables, data types, structures, and so on. Advanced SQL support, it would be nice to have as well, because we feel that iQuest tool kind of limited in this ability. For example, when you want to build complex SQL query, it's not always as advanced as a standard SQL language. Push notifications instead of polling. What I mean on this is this. In many cases, we have multiple applications and workflows that touch the same S3 storage besides IROTS. And if your data have been deleted by some other process, this change needs to be reflected in IROTS catalog as well. So we are not done this yet, but we definitely need to think how to implement this in future. Database performance optimization. When we are talking about cloud, it's probably not that important, because if you see that your database needs more memory or CPU power, you could quickly upgrade database instance. But in many cases on local, probably better work on indexing and maybe SQL queries and some other database constraints could be done. User-friendly front-end, I already mentioned this. It would be nice to have to see more functionality in Metalinks in cloud browsers, web browsers, improved documentation, and last but not least, maybe at some point we could engage Amazon EC2 spot instances for IROTS workers. And this way, if IROTS servers see that more workers require, it will span EC2 instances to do this job. And once job is completed, EC2 instance just go away. But of course, IROTS servers should be capable to pick up any job would become terminated by Amazon, because Amazon could terminate spot instance at any moment. So next steps, how we want to deploy IROTS in BMS. Once we finish data synchronization between storage on cloud, we want to deliver continuous data scans for all S3 buckets in our object store. We want to complete checksums, so for advanced data validation. Metadata and enrichment of metadata is very critical step as well, because all these projects data needs to be well tagged, and it's very important for our scientists. We need to improve data governance and users access for IROTS, and it's a lot of work because we have huge number of different projects and different teams inside of BMS what require different levels of access and have different patterns and requirements. Some advanced development for IROTS probably will also require, because we need to develop a lot of rules, policies, what calls for extensive Python coding. We plan to finish our integration between IROTS and Enterprise Data Lake. We need to implement LDAP integrations for user authentication in IROTS. IROTS auditing plugin is also on our roadmap. Last but very critical step, we will deploy IROTS for our teams inside of BMS, and we want to set up IROTS Federation. So we call it BMS Data Farm. And this is pretty much it. I just want to say thank you again for Jason and Terrell especially, who supports a lot of these activities. And thank you to large BMS teams who built all these services inside my company. And thank you.
So if we've got any questions for Oleg, he does have a lot of teams, and there's a lot of coordination going on, and a lot of them don't even know the words yet, which is a lot of the challenge also. They're learning all the words here.
Hi. So the S3 storage is used as back-end storage for IROTS. Does it mean that all applications and users always have to go through IROTS to access data, or do you also have discovered a possibility for applications to directly access the data which is already lying on S3?
I wish it would be that simple. Just ask all applications and user leverage IROTS to access our data. Unfortunately, it's not quite easy to do. So some data definitely would be accessible through IROTS only, and other data sets will continue to work with other applications, and that's why at some point it will be important for us to reflect all changes done with our data outside of IROTS, within IROTS.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, there's a lot of scanning. So right now our conversations are about who's in charge, because a lot of the legacy stuff that's there has to be scanned.
Hey, first of all, that's great. I think that's where I want to be in maybe on Monday, but then I saw you have stuff like you're using RDS, but at least the slide says for Redis you're still using your own EC2 instance, or like not everything that Amazon provides is being used as an Amazon service. Is there a specific reason to that, or is that just because it came to be that way, historical reasons?
Yes, so we use RDS, and I think this is a great platform as a service from Amazon. It's really convenient because, in fact, there are a bunch of databases in my company. And today we're trying to move all these databases from local on-premises to a cloud. And that's why at the time when we decided to deploy iRoads in BMS, it was obvious choice for us to engage RDS for iRoads. I think our services, database related and memory cache related on Amazon site, definitely could be used for other components of iRoads. But at that time, when we made the first deployment of iRoads, we were not quite ready to change significantly iRoads architecture, so we decided to play safe. But I think in future, when we will about to deploy another iRoads environment within my company, we could consider this.
And the second question is there a specific reason why you partition among more buckets than it seems strictly necessary?
I would say it's pretty much legacy thing, because these buckets have been there before iRoads, and we currently have hundreds of them. So iRoads just will scan all of them in round-robin fashion. Ideally, maybe every hour, because changes to this bucket could come from many other places. So I wish to have just 2-3 buckets, but it's not a choice.
Okay.
Got one last question, and then we go stand outside.
About your comment about the advanced SQL, are you aware of the fact that iQuest can use custom SQL? If you look at iQuest --SQL and iAdmin ASQ, that'll probably give you what you want.
Thank you, John, for saying this. I was not aware. We will definitely explore this. If it works well, this is nice.
Yeah. Works well for us.
Thanks.
All right. Well, thank you, Oleg.
Thank you, everyone.